I'm very happy to see you both, Mrs. Bokova, Mr. Federico Maior. At least for my generation, you were, Federico Maior, were discussing about age. To see two of the, I would say, best director generals of UNESCO together in this session, for me, it's a great and I'm sure Gary is the guilty one. Because in fact, I think this is the biggest challenge of any times, and we have this responsibility. And somehow I'm opening already the conference, because the name of this conference, fifth conference on education of the World Academy of Art and Science, is trying to see the future of education. And yes, we have quite a list of speakers today. We have former director generals of UNESCO. We have the current president of UN General Assembly, and also two former presidents of two countries, Mauritius and Romania. As an educator and as a rector today and former Minister of Education, I do have a lot of questions related to future of education. And we hope, this fifth conference of the World Academy of Art and Science will have at least a small contribution to try to clarify some of these questions. And my first question, which it's unclear for me, again, as a university professor and rector of a university, is what's the meaning of a university today? In fact, this is just to copy and paste the name of a class which I had 20 years ago in George Washington University, when the professor proposed to us to speak about the meaning of a university. And in my mind, immediately, I had the following question, which now I am ashamed of this, but that was in my mind. What kind of discussion is this? We know exactly what a university is. How can we ask again, what is a university? But after the class, I realized my judgment was really superficial. I was coming from Romania, somehow influenced by the way university was seen in Romania during the 80s and early 90s. And I realized, in fact, the university that we have in mind today, and in fact, the university which I run today, it's a university which has the roots in 19th century and is not necessarily the fitted one for 21st or 22nd century. So I'm not saying this in order to deny the current model. Probably the current model will exist for many years or many centuries. But the question is, if this model is enough, it's enough in order to reach the objectives that we announced, or our politicians announced very proudly, including access and equity to higher education. And also the context changed drastically. The university where I teach today was established after the revolution in Romania in 1990 in order to prepare people in international relations, political science, public administration, a kind of, in fact, École Nationale d'Administration was a kind of model, and later on Kennedy School of Government. So that was a university designed for a specific purpose. But is this appropriate today, or would be 20 years by now? For sure, we have to put these questions. And also, there are many, many other questions. The mobility of people and mobility of teachers, professors, have increased drastically in the last decades. How do we, for example, recognize a student as a student if he or she moves from one place to another? How do we recognize diplomas? What about the financing of education? Who is responsible? What about quality? Who is deciding the content? And also, we are discussing, and we have also in our current conference, the topic of sustainable development. How can we claim we are going to reach these objectives in 2030 when many academic programs have nothing about sustainable development today? So is this the university that we want, or is this a university for the future? What about the differences between not different parts of the world, but different parts of the same country, where in some places you have 16 universities somewhere around 20 kilometers, and in other places you have no university or academic program on an area of 200 kilometers. So is this access and equity? And again, in simple countries, not in sophisticated countries, when the differences and the resources are really difficult to share equally among young people. What about digitalization? You said, Federico, I am a young person. When I interact with my kids, I don't have the same feeling, especially when I see the speed they work and use this comparing with the way I use it. Are we speaking in the same technological language? For sure, the future, their future, will be 100% a technological and digital future. Ours, it's the way it is. All of these are questions, and are questions not necessarily for academics or for people working in the Ministry of Education or in the government, but I think they are common questions across the world. When you speak about internationalization, recognition of diploma, when you speak about content, when you speak about reaching some global objectives, that means we have to have some common approaches when we speak about education. The last idea, and I'll conclude in order to let our speakers today in the panel to introduce their ideas, is related to the connection between higher education and the world that we see down. When I say down, meaning primary, secondary education, and the world that we see up. That means after the graduation of our students. How do we really connect with this? Because we cannot have good students without good primary and secondary education. We cannot speak about access and equity in higher education if we don't have very strong access and equity policies at primary and secondary. And our graduates will not succeed in the real world if we don't connect daily with the real world. So thank you for allowing me to have this introductory remark. And now I'm really honored and happy to invite Federico Maier, Director General of UNESCO, former Minister of Education, and many, many other important positions to have the floor for the next 8 to 10 minutes. Federico, you have the floor.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much. I am really today very interested in this meeting because it gives me hope. You know, I think that today what we really need is to see how can we really, at this very moment, historical moment, to redress the present trends. And for this, I think that this initiative of the World Academy of Art and Science, of the World University Consortium, of the NSDA, of the International Association of Presidents of University is really very timely, because now the time for action has arrived. We have been during so many decades only spectators of what was happening. Now the universities, the in general, the scientific, academic, intellectual, artistic communities, they have a special role. I like very much when Gary Jacobs was already during the last 5 years telling us that what we need is a new kind of leadership. We must now not be only listening and knowing what happens. Now we must come to action. And it is for this that I like very much when it is said that we have a global leadership of higher education for the effective multilateralism and sustainable development. Because now, for the first time in history, I insist, this is feasible. I have been very interested also with the concept notes that have been published. And I must congratulate Gary Jacobs and all those that have been working in the Alberto Zucconi, etc., in the Cadmus paper and in the note, concept note of this meeting that can be as a guidance for all those that are going to participate during these days in this meeting. And I also like very much, as former Director General of UNESCO, to see here Irina Vokova, to know that Audrey Azoulay is going to also contribute to this meeting, and persons like Gabriela Ramos and Estefania Giannini that are really wonderful. And all women, they can give us this kind of new vision that is so necessary at this moment. Now, you have made us a question. You have said, what is the meaning of university today? And I like very much this today, because I have been now more than near 65 years related with universities. And now I realize that today we can act in a way that until now was not feasible. Because 30 years ago, 40 years ago, when President Roosevelt said in the first phrase, that is a wonderful phrase of the United Nations system, he said in the charter, "We the peoples, eh? We the peoples, we have resolved to save the succeeding generations from the scourge of war." Was fantastic. We the peoples. But the peoples were not existent at this moment, because I remember when I was rector of Granada that I was thinking, who are the persons that are coming and today are able to participate? Was less than 10%, because world, 90% of the peoples, of we the peoples, were human beings that were being born, living and dying in 40 kilometers square and nothing more, because they have not the possibility of expressing themselves, their views. They were not able to know what was happening at the worldwide level. And particularly, they were always under an absolute male power. Male power. Women was absolutely excluded of all these possibilities of action. Now, on the contrary, from around 25-30 years ago, now progressively, there is no more discrimination. This was terrible. Gender discrimination. Women was always set aside. There was discrimination because of sexual sensitivity, because of ideology, because of the beliefs or the ethnia, color of the skin. Now, and this is very important to tell you the answer today. Now, for the first time, progressively, there is no discrimination anymore, and the women are having the role that they can have, and all the human beings are equal in dignity. I think that this is in the preamble of the UNESCO's constitution, and this is essential. All human beings equal in dignity. Now all human beings equal in dignity now can already act, and they can act together, and they can join all their efforts for this leadership that Gary Jacobs is recommending to the universities from many years now. And at this respect, I like to repeat concerning what is education, because we are in higher education. And what is education? Because there are many economic institutions that are telling us what is education, but from the point of view of being consumers of other aspects of the economy and the social problems. No. What really matters is what is in UNESCO, it is said in the article number 1 of the Constitution, says, to be educated is to be free and responsible. Today, we need to be free and responsible, because we are not responsible if we do not act. Now we know what must be done. Now we know that there are, and you know this very well, the Agenda 2030 to transform the world. We must change our way of life. You know, I remember that Edgar Morin in France, when he was 100 years old, he said, il faut changer de voix. And now I told him, changeons de vie. It's not only to change our way of action, we must change also our style of life. We must realize that now the moment is arrived for all the peoples to be responsible and to be acting in favor of this very important sustainable objectives that we must put into practice. As a scientist, I must add that I know very well that irreversible, I have been always against and trying to prevent irreversible situations. It's terrible to say this has no remedy anymore. Therefore, now for the first time in history, we have global threats that are irreversible. But at the same time, we have the possibility of working all together, women, men, everybody, because all of us, we are equal in dignity. And also for the first time, and this in part because of the digital technology, we can express ourselves. We can participate. We can therefore participate in the democratic multilateralism. We can now tell all these people that during the last decades has been with the G6, G7, G8, with a neoliberal plutocratic governance that has been absolutely malicious for the humanity as a whole. Now we have the possibility of telling them, now, yes, now we can say, we the peoples, because now we the peoples, we can exist and we can act and we can react. And at the same time, we can participate. It's for this that I consider that the consultation that you have done to us, saying what is the meaning of the university today, is to say the universities as the communities, the intellectual communities, is to say there is a hope, because every human being is able to create, is able to think, is able to imagine, is able to innovate, is able to create. We have a creator in all human beings. Therefore, what we must do is to be able to realize that we have this immense potential, that now we can participate, we can create a new future. And I think that the universities, the communities, artistic, intellectual, etc., must have the leadership at this respect.
Professor Federico Maior, while you were Director General of UNESCO, I was a student. So I never heard you having a speech as Director General, but I read many of your speeches. And I noticed, as a professor of public communications, the optimism in your all public interventions, including today. You are speaking about hope. You are speaking about being able to understand, and we are prepared to understand the future. Thank you for your intervention, and I'm sure we'll have the time when we'll have the short questions and round to develop more. Let me now introduce Irina Bokova. I had the chance to hear many of her speeches because we worked together while Irina was the Director General. Irina, you have the floor.
Thank you very much, Remus, and thank you very much for this opportunity. Dear Gary, I'm so pleased to be with you here with such great leaders and intellectuals and thinkers. My deep respect to Federico Maior, my dear predecessor, and to whom I want once again to express my admiration. Dear Amina, dear Maria Fernanda, we have worked with you also a lot in the area of education, of science, of course, on sustainable development. Very privileged to be in this panel also with the President Emil Constantinescu. I would say that for me, as a newly elected fellow of the World Academy of Arts and Science, this is indeed an opportunity once again to express my respect for the immense contribution that both the Academy, but equally the World Consortium of Universities has done for the thinking about the future of education. We all know that education is the foundation of human development. And I would say nowadays also of human security, a topic that is very high on the agenda. We know it is vital for our health. It is vital for gender equality, for jobs, the protection of environment, fighting climate change, and living together in diversity. In other words, education is where our future lies. Hence the importance of this conference. But I would say not any education. And Remus rightfully pointed out to the evolution of the thinking about education, and it is in the concept paper. Education means learning that is transformative, equitable, that embraces innovation and diversity, and that encourages creativity and the possibility for young people and for all the society to make choices. Education that supports students and other learners in different areas to develop necessary knowledge, skills, mindset, as Don Federico just mentioned, to contribute to solving complex, sustainable development challenges the world faces today. Of course, I'm with this very short speech of mine, I do not pretend to exhaust all the aspects, but I would just like to make three points. The first is that we have to reconfirm our commitment to the Sustainable Development Agenda 2030, where I believe education is at its heart. The pandemic and its consequences has served as a wake-up call for all of humanity to put education and health, I would say human security and well-being, to the forefront of public policies. And if today we speak about building back, not just building back, but building back better, one sure path is investing in people, investing in economies and societies that are clean, green, healthy, safe, and more resilient. And this is where the importance of goal number four of the Sustainable Development Agenda, promoting inclusive and equitable quality education and lifelong learning for all, comes with its critical importance for the future. We know that all stages of education are important, and Remus also mentioned the holistic view of education. And I think for the first time ever, this holistic view was very much incorporated into the goal number four, where also for the first time, it embraced the role of universities. And the role of universities in all the areas of education, of science, of research, of innovation is nowadays immense. Universities indeed have a growing responsibility to translate this challenge of sustainable development to local circumstances through research, through learning, teaching, leadership, intellectual leadership, campus operations, and others. And if we speak nowadays that universities should create this learning environment to foster skills both for the 17 Sustainable Development Goals, but also for the emerging challenges of the fourth industrial revolution, as I said, through teaching, pedagogical means, educating global citizens and others, I believe that one of the main responsibilities of universities nowadays indeed is to create in young people critical thinking, but also to embrace change. In some ways, I would say that when we speak about creating this need for sustainable development, embracing this, this kind of becomes the new intellectual challenge, the new intellectual discipline in front of the universities, but equally also the organizing principle for universities in our time. Now, when we speak, many experts today speak about the fusion of technologies that are blurring the lines between the physical, the digital, the biological spheres. There is an increasing need for higher education to search for responses for both their positive economic, social, environmental impacts, as well as the challenges they represent for us, for human beings. And this is my second point. Many experts insist also that effective education strategy must include in equal measure a deep consideration of the human, the ways in which new technologies and shifting economic power impact people of all socioeconomical levels, and the threats that exist within a world that is increasingly interconnected. So I would like to quote here, and I'm sure that Federico and Gary would support what I would like to quote here, the great French intellectual and thinker of the 20th century, Claude Lévi-Strauss, who was for some time also closely linked with UNESCO and very much influenced also the thinking about race, ethnicity, culture, and diversity. He did influence also the thinking behind the linkages between the social and natural sciences, a topic that is very high, I believe, on the agenda of education, of scientists, of thinkers today. He famously said, recommending the unification of methodological thinking between the exact sciences and human sciences, the speculations of the earliest geometers and arithmeticians were concerned with men far more than with the physical world. Pythagoras, for one, was deeply interested in anthropological significance of numbers and figures, as were the sages of China, India, pre-colonial Africa, and pre-Columbian America, which were preoccupied with the meaning and specific attributes of numbers. So if the future economy, education, health, and jobs is digital, it is important that education prepares young people for such an economy where problem solving, innovation, and creativity is valued, and where lifelong learning becomes the norm, not the exception. This is another area where I know that the World University Consortium and the World Academy of Art and Science is working on how universities can work in with flexibility and openness, a very, in my view, relevant and interesting debate. It needs, and it will require major changes in content and pedagogical work, certification, delivery systems, but I believe there is the future which lies ahead of us. And if we say that effective education strategy must include in equal measure a deep consideration of the human, then the issue between culture, arts, and education come forward strong, in my view. And this is my third point. Aesthetic education, embracing art in all its diversity, is an essential component of comprehensive education. On one side, I deeply believe that culture acts as a catalyst for economic and social development, and for the first time is recognized in the United Nations Agenda for Sustainable Development 2030. This is particularly important today when humanity confronts the challenges of rebuilding a post-pandemic world. This cannot be done without culture and both citizens' awareness and engagement. Scientific research also shows time and time again that there is close link between education and culture. And then aesthetic education has an extremely positive impact on both academic achievement, social and emotional development, civic engagement, and equal opportunities further on in life. Research shows also the involvement in arts is associated with gains in mathematics, reading, cognitive ability, critical thinking, and verbal skill. Art learning can also improve motivation, concentration, confidence, and teamwork. STEAM education should become the normal approach to teaching students creativity and how to solve complex problems. And I would say, one of the last points I would like to say, this brings me to the important topics of teaching arts and humanities, of which I have been a strong advocate when I was at UNESCO. I deeply believe that it is through humanities and arts that we understand the social transformation of our societies and the way to manage it for the benefit of all. it is through humanities and arts that we understand and get to know the history and culture of others. It is through humanities and arts and the culture also that we understand better the challenges of globalization. And it is through humanities and arts that we understand and embrace cultural diversity as a strength and not as a threat. So teaching philosophy or history of arts is fundamental for the opening of young minds towards the diversity and the other. It is the constant challenge of the present that can make one imagining and reinventing the future. I was thinking about that, Don Federico, when you were speaking, that we have to reinvent the future. And I think this is precisely what we have to do now through education. A book can, or a lesson of philosophy, may change the perception of the world, may instill empathy and the sense of belonging. Knowing one's own history, culture, and heritage creates a sense of belonging. Knowing others' history, culture, and heritage creates a sense of sharing and solidarity. And the role of university in this endeavor is indeed critical, as their main function at the end of the day is to make a significant contribution to society. Because universities are not now, nor ever have been, solely focused on preparing young people just for the workforce. It is about values and citizenship, about preparing young people to give back to their communities and to live in a globalized world. So I believe that universities and higher education should be no strangers to the new vision that was proposed by UNESCO, created by UNESCO in 2015, incorporated in the goal number 4 about global citizenship education in the 21st century. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Irina. I totally agree with your position. In fact, I am not surprised with this position because you have very clearly stated during your mandate as Director General in UNESCO. We were also happy to listen to you when you had the Dr. Honoris Causa discourse in front of my students. So once again, congratulations for your very strong position for education. We know very well, if we look at the history of education, for many centuries, education didn't exist on the agenda of the government. Later on, education became a governmental issue, but with a very clear focus related to the objectives of the government. And in other words, education was just a national responsibility, a national issue. Even today, there are governments considering education is strictly their responsibility, when in fact, it's true, education is a local responsibility, but with local and global impact. And in your discourses, when we talk about global responsibilities, global objectives, we cannot reach this without people educated in a global perspective. From this point of view, I think we have achieved a lot, and the role of UNESCO and United Nations to underline the importance of education as a global local responsibility, but with global impact, is clear, even being included in the Sustainable Development Goals. So I'm very happy and honored to have today the official voice of United Nations General Assembly, the President, Maria Espinosa. You have the floor, and I'm looking forward to see your opinion on the future of higher education.
Thank you. Thank you so much, dear fellow panelists. It is such a privilege to share with you this space with such incredible leaders, thinkers, Federico Mayor, a great role model, and Irene and Gary, of course. Thank you to the World Academy of Arts and Science. Thank you, Gary Jacobs. It's so great to see you with such a great energy. And of course, thank you to the World University Consortium. And I say thank you because you are devoting three full days to discuss an issue of critical importance for the future of humankind, which is the future of higher education for effective multilateralism and sustainable human security. And what we have in these 3 days is more than 100 scholars and thinkers from all regions of the world in 14 sessions. So there is a truly an impressive lineup of speakers, a wide thematic scope from human security and education for peace to the role of arts and new technologies and digitalization. So thank you to the authors for the very comprehensive and stimulating discussion paper for the conference. I highly recommend it's a must read a reference document. So inspired by the paper, I would like today to address three challenges that I see for higher education: the complexity challenge, the decolonization challenge, and the inequality challenge. Needless to say that we are living times of deep, interconnected, nested crises. So when we speak about crises, we hear the climate emergency, the extinction threat, global health, and the queen of all the crises, the crises of inequalities. And however, you know, truth be told, climate, extinction, global health are symptoms of a more profound systemic civilizational crisis that can, in my opinion, be depicted as a profound fracture of the relationship between humans, the economy, nature, and politics. I strongly believe that higher education, and education more widely, as Federico was saying at the beginning, should be geared towards healing this fracture, reconnecting the grid of life, reconciling, making peace with nature in these times of barbarity, these times of uncertainty and fear. And let me start now with the complexity challenge. Our world is increasingly complex. Crises are interconnected. And therefore, responses should also reflect this complexity and use a holistic lens. We need absolutely to enrich our epistemologies, shape a true intercultural, cross-disciplinary higher education. In short, in few words, we need an effort of translation, as Irina was saying. We need to resignify the world. We need new categories to explain, to better understand the world, so we can be and act in a less, I would say, destructive and selfish way as humans. So we are witnessing an increasing trend of highly specialized higher education, a zoom-in-like education. And I also believe that we need a panoramic lens first to understand and capture the landscape, the context. Science and technology, for example, cannot be understood or exercised if we don't understand society and the social scaffold in which they are embedded and the people they should serve. Ethics in science is critical to ensure that scientific knowledge and new technologies do not counter human rights and nature's rights, for that matter. Higher education for the 21st century should, in few words, and thinking about the great Edgar Morin's seven complex lessons in education for the future, where he clearly calls for blurring boundaries between disciplines in contemporary knowledge. And also he calls for the urgent need for an education that reflects the complexity and interconnectedness of our world and the challenges that we face collectively as humankind. So a new higher education paradigm should allow for true intergenerational, intercultural co-creation of new societal designs. And this should be the basis for a new social contract. that has become now a mantra. Everybody speaks about the need for a new social contract. And this is much needed as we reinvent ourselves during and after the COVID-19 pandemic. And this, of course, requires that we are equipped with a different mindset. We cannot continue to operate under a linear, fragmentary logic with a Cartesian thinking. We rather need a systems thinking based on complexity to better capture the variable geometry that we live in. So my second point is the decolonization challenge. And this is deeply connected with the complexity challenge. If we are to enrich our comprehension and knowledge toolbox, it is imperative that we work in a cross-disciplinary, but also a cross-cultural form of higher education. The authority, the hierarchy, the legitimacy of one school of thought, of Western epistemologies, of methodological monism, considered to be above or more having more authority than other equally sophisticated, equally valid epistemologies and worldviews. And this idea, I think, should be challenged in the new higher education that we want to build and shape. And this is, of course, this idea of decolonizing education is not a very original argument, I have to say. Edward Said, Orientalism, Homi Bhabha, and so many others in post-colonial theory have profusely explained this issue. And here I would like to briefly quote Sharon Stein when she writes that decolonization is not a single event or prescribed blueprint, but a complex contested process of unlearning and undoing centuries of colonial ideas, desires, and infrastructures. And of course, these are complex processes. There are no magical solutions. And at the end of the day, bringing cultural diversity as a scaffold for a richer, higher education will require addressing and unpacking the vestiges of colonialism and neocolonial manifestations. So in other words, diverse epistemologies, eclectic approaches to knowledge are central to tackle the complexity of our times. And I am convinced that it is possible. Having spent several years working with indigenous peoples of my country, Ecuador, I can say that often I learn more working and living with them than during my many years in academia. So quality intercultural education, higher education is possible. Cross-cultural education is central to build a sense of shared destiny, to care for our earth system, which is our common heritage. And for that, we need a shared consciousness as well. And here, my last challenge, which is the inequalities challenge. And I think the paper for the conference is so clear about this issue. The question is very simple. It's an arithmetic issue that has ethical, political, and policy implications. The message, I said, is so clear. It means that transactional inequalities in society by income, class, gender, ethnicity are mirrored in the coverage and quality of, in higher education. And these inequalities increased and boosted by the COVID-19 crisis are going to make things a little more difficult. If you take women, persons with disabilities, indigenous peoples, they are among the most affected by these inequalities. And we know that there is a growing demand for higher education, and yet there is not enough investment, infrastructure, teachers to face the increasing demand. And the bad news are that in current fiscal crisis in developing countries will, of course, have an impact in public investment in higher education. So we are already witnessing alarming trends in many countries, especially in the global south. So in the paradox here, friends, is that we know that access to higher education, or rather to education at large, is one of the greater social equalizers. And this means that if we are to rethink higher education globally, we also need to rethink about the redistribution of funding, infrastructure, digital resources, and of course, we need to rethink the issue of pertinence and quality. But this rethinking, this much needed transformation cannot happen in isolation as one-off experiment of from a community or even a country. It has to be a global, well-orchestrated effort, following on the amazing efforts of UNESCO. And here we have among us two former director generals of UNESCO. And I think this is precisely what gathers us in this conference, thinking collectively about a much needed transformation of higher education. And these three challenges that I just outlined have profound impacts in the way we shape and organize global governance structures, how we equip multilateral institutions that are human-made, human-led, with the persons, the humans, the professionals that are needed to make these institutions fit for purpose. And fit for purpose mean ready to deal with complexity, volatility, and unpredictability. And therefore, this conference, I would say, is of paramount importance. It speaks to the need of a new global choreography for our rejuvenated, inclusive, human, complex higher education based on the very principles that guided the creation of the international organization. So we need to go back to the basics, to the principles that created our multilateral institutions, including the United Nations, solidarity, cooperation, dialogue. We need a renovated global governance system for the Anthropocene. That is the collective task that we have ahead of us. This also means that efforts for a global retooling of higher education should be based on a sort of new literacy for a value-based multilateral system. A new paradigm in higher education should therefore, we prepare, you know, good doctors, good engineers, nurses, artists, writers, astronauts, but they also have to be at the same time global citizens, critical thinkers, with specific skills, of course, but with a sense of belonging to a broader community, to an Earth system. And let me close with a quote again by the great Edgar Morin, when he said, "Today, the fundamental global objective of all education, aspiring not only to progress, but to the survival of humanity, is to civilize and unify the Earth and transform the human species into genuine humanity. The education of the future should teach an ethics of planetary understanding." I wish us all a great conference, and I am convinced that after these intense 3 days, we will have the pieces of the puzzle that we can and should collectively put together to co-create a pathway to a profound and radical transformation of higher education. Thank you. Thank you again, and back to you, Remus.
Thank you very much. Thank you for your comprehensive approach of the topic, from philosophical one to very practical one. You underline the finance issue and, for example, a very simple question, but with difficult answers. How we are going to mind the gap between different countries when you have the gap between the budgets of the two countries? So that means a national approach will never address the education gap. That means we need a global approach. And the second issue, you underline the, in fact, it was also underlined by the other speakers, the idea of citizenship. You know, I graduated teacher training, and at one moment attending a conference, I realized I might be in a situation not understanding the definition of education. I was minister, and I heard from Brussels people saying, we have to train our graduates for the labor market. And I said, how come? Because the definition of education I learned while I was a student is broader. And I checked the definitions for almost 200 years in different countries, and all the time I found exactly the same definition: personal development, labor market, and citizenship. And the issue today is the fact that all these words we use exactly the same, but they have different meaning. Personal development 100 years ago was the priest, the professor in the small town, maybe the father, the uncle. Today, personal development means also be inspired by someone from YouTube. Second, labor market. We have already a global labor market, and citizenship is not any longer Romanian citizenship. It's also European citizenship. It's also global citizenship. But the model of education is the same. So this, in fact, what we are going to discover, if we will be able, and I'm really eager to see the opinion of former two presidents of two different countries, and also with a very serious academic background. I'll introduce, I hope my pronunciation will be good, and please, if not, excuse me, Aminah Gurib Fakim. And after that, it would be my honor to introduce Professor and President Emil Constantinescu. But the first lady elected president, Federico Maior, was underlying the landscape change from different point of view, including related to the participation of ladies to decision, which is normal, and I'm happy to see the situation is changing. Please, Mrs. President, you have the floor.
Thank you very much, Remus, and your pronunciation was perfect, so no worries about that. thank you, Gary. It's good to see you, that you are with us, looking good, and also for associating me with this very important event. And I think, as you have said when we met last time in Baku, it is time to rethink the way we approach education. And I'm also very pleased to be seeing that there are two past president of UNESCO on board with us. And I will listen to our friend Maria, her excellent presentation on the whole approach to education, the way we look at it. And what I will talk about today may seem a little bit like the utopian world that we are also thinking about when we look at education from the global south, because we know that we're increasingly looking at what has been said all the time, I think in scope, how to mind the gap. How to mind the gap between our discourse and what is happening on the ground. But we'll still proceed, and I think it is time, as we have rightly said throughout, to keep on reinventing our world and to keep on reinventing this very fundamental aspect of our life. And of course, what brings us all together here is the fundamentals of education. Ladies and gentlemen, we have seen that the spread of information and communication technology and global interconnectedness has huge potential to accelerate human progress and to bridge the digital divide, and also to develop knowledge societies. Our global society pledged in 2015, and I quote, to leave no one behind by approving Agenda 2030. However lofty the ideals may be, and no matter how many reforms will bring on board, they will be sorely inadequate to achieve significantly strengthened effective international governance if attention is not paid to engage the support and participation of all those inhabitants of the planet whom the institution of governance are meant to serve. Public education to understand our common humanity and the global good will only be an essential support to their success. Crucially, relevant education is needed for who those will provide leadership or participate in governance processes, and will need new skills, new ways of thinking relevant to their roles in strengthening international institutions. So how do we build public support? Fortunately, with information technologies, this is no longer an unrealistic goal. One prerequisite may be the initial support of a range of governments, as their cooperation will be important in reaching the population through the formal school system and national media. Engagement of at least some governments would add significant weight to an influential international campaign for strengthening global governance and at the heart of public education. Our shared human identity is a biological fact, and greater international solidarity among people has become technologically possible in a world physically reduced to a neighborhood. People should be reassured, nonetheless, that their national autonomy, cultural diversity, and personal freedom and initiative will be safeguarded. Public education also needs to take account of the emotional and psychological dimensions of reform processes. Unfortunately, today's nationalism, nativism, and xenophobia are rooted in fear of the other, which can be prevented and countered through education. Fear generally comes from ignorance. This is fueling conspiracy theories and the frustration of those that have not benefited from globalization or who have lost their dignity and place in society, leaving them open to populist messages. Ladies and gentlemen, the inevitably increasing migration driven by climate change and sea level rise, and I think here I speak from the heart, coming from an island nation, driving among other driving forces, might be viewed as a constructive mixing of peoples if supported by education that presents human diversity in a positive light. Relatively successful national policies approaches to build cultures of diversity proactively should be meaningful, explored as models, and improved upon at the international level. Education lies at the heart of community building, and such education needs to start at a very early age. While global governance may seem very distant from local communities throughout the world, communities are in fact the ultimate foundation for all levels of governance. The expression of think globally and act locally captures this idea very well. The values of unity and diversity, solidarity, moderation, and service to others are as important at the local or at the global level and should be reflected in educational activities for all age groups in communities. Local action can be linked to global awareness by emphasizing the idea that each person is playing a small part in the global enterprise of constructing a positive, sustainable peace in the world. The essential foundation for an active citizenry, of course, is universal basic education, as a literate and educated public is essential for the effective functioning of a democratic processes and public participation at any level. While progress has been discussed and been made in many countries, unfortunately, we still have over 750 million illiterate people, and these were the figures in 2015. Ladies and gentlemen, the challenge is universal implementation by governments in their school systems. Universal quality education must become a priority for all governments. Where governments are unable to provide this, this should become a responsibility of the international community and the UN system to supply the necessary means. And I weigh my words here because I think a small fraction of the amount presently spent on arms would be sufficient. States have also obligated themselves to work on education to address specific global risk. And climate change has been raised already. So I think if you look at the framework, the UN Framework Convention on Climate Change, Article 6 states that parties should promote and facilitate the development and implementation of educational and public awareness program on climate change and its effect. If parties had taken this obligation seriously, the Paris Agreement would have a more solid foundation. A second later step will be to define more systematized universal core curriculum for the different levels of formal education that would include essential ethical principle, human rights, civic responsibilities, grounding in the roles and functions of international institutions. Education ministries are notably conservative about change, requiring special efforts to help them understand their important role. This should be one essential component of the commitment governments must take to support steps to strengthen global governance. In tertiary education, there will be sufficient educational research opportunities across a range of our areas requiring global governance. International institutions will need well-trained civil servants, and national government will also need to strengthen the structures that interface with global institutions. Certain core skills, such as skills to system thinking and ethical principles upon which governance is founded, need to be widely taught as part of general education. Student exchange programs at universities and international level, and here which are already occurring with unprecedented frequency, can be further systematized as the European Union has employed the Erasmus International European Student Exchange Program, building a new generation of European citizens. The time may well come in the future when government will see the need for an official international auxiliary language that could provide everyone with a means for intercommunication with an evolving global system, while still protecting national and subnational language diversity. Religious organizations in particular have both formal education institutions and Sunday school, madrasas, children classes, or other community education activities. The moral and ethical values behind a more successful, peaceful, just, and sustainable world, including good governance and social justice, respect for others, moderation, and other spiritual values, can easily find their place in these educational programs. Ladies and gentlemen, the potential of the internet to reach the vast majority of humanity has expanded so rapidly that we are far from understanding the best ways to employ this potential for the common good. The popularity of social media should be harnessed to misspread the main messages about the cultivation of global solidarity, the ethical principles being applied, and the practical steps being taken to make enhanced and functional global governance a reality for everyone. Resources on UN reform and global governance should be freely available on the internet and the range of social media platforms in formal languages accessible to many audiences, with coverage and explanation of the main events as before we discussed and implemented. The capacity of online education, whether in courses offered by the formal education institution, the MOOCs, can reach many thousands or less formal opportunities for continuing education, all have great potential to build human capacity with a minimum of resources. Reform processes shall be accompanied by a wide range of online educational opportunities, both to build public understanding and to prepare people for the very many emerging opportunities for service and employment. As public opinion in most countries is formed by the mass media, it is clear that the media should have an important role in covering and explaining the various steps taken to reform and strengthen the UN systems. Better education of journalists on these issues would be an important measure, along with the provision of access to reliable sources of information for journalistic communities. Without undermining the complementary role of independent journalism, the UN News Service, should explain the sometimes arcane ways of international diplomacy stories that the general public can understand. It should earn the confidence of people everywhere so that questions concerning the veracity of other reports can be compared with a reliable and objective global source. The built-in bias of national perspective is well known, particularly where there are issues of conflict between states. This could be neutralized with facts from the UN itself. It is clear that the reformed United Nations need capacities in a range of domains relevant to education, including support of public education for global citizenship, and new flows on UN reform and actions around the world, a significant presence of the internet and social media, and close links with the national government it serves. It should create a global framework with ethical journalism, free access to science, and other knowledge necessary for the good functioning of global governance and safeguards against infringement of every individual right to education, general knowledge, and objective information. So I end by saying that as the global system matures, the UN could and should become a guarantor of the quality of leadership at the national level in service to the common good, both nationally and internationally. And I thank you for your attention.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Mrs. President. Thank you for also approaching in a holistic way the issue of education and challenges, I would like to underline just one topic related to educational agents. Generally, when we are unsatisfied with education, we are blaming immediately the school, the university. But we forget our kids are exposed to different agents of education. Mass media, for example, is such an agent. Or today, all social networks are even stronger agents of education than the school. So another reason to speak about the model of education. If this model, which was built long before the social networks appeared, it's still the one that we have to keep or we have to assess in a very positive way, but to assess the weaknesses and to try to adapt to today's challenges. I mentioned twice during this session, I graduated teacher training program. While I was a student in Bucharest University, the president of the university was Professor Emil Constantinescu, later on president of Romania. So I'm very happy to introduce to this panel my former rector and president of Bucharest University and my former president. Professor Constantinescu, you have the floor.
Thank you. Good afternoon, distinguished guest, dear friends. Now, I would like to begin my intervention by congratulating the World Academy of Art of Science, the World University Consortium, and the National School for Political and Administrative Studies for the decision to organize the fifth edition of the Conference of the Future of Education, especially now. Why now, you may ask yourselves? Because I find that at the moment, the world needs to focus all the more on its future and not dwell on its troubled present. As we are gathering today online to debate the future of education, the world is facing a new variant of the SARS-CoV-2 virus, Omicron. Although the name sounds like the newest invention in the field of technology, Omicron, in fact, is said to be spinning around the symptoms of the common cold and transforming it into something which is for now very much feared. As countries entering again the red zone and facing more and more restrictions, the World Academy of Art of Science, in a joint effort with the World University Consortium and the National School of Political and Administrative Studies, at gathering the worldwide scientists to discuss topics related to the challenges of the 21st century for students, innovative delivery systems that could help improve the interaction within the educational field, human security and the culture of peace, values, ethics, and their social impact, the engagement of creativity in the development of sustainable education, gender balance and gender promotion in education, and many other hot topics. I congratulate you once again for the impressive choice of the topics and the wide range of specialists put together for this event. And I do it wholeheartedly as an educator myself, in full belief that the future can only be constructed and achieved according to our desires and ideas only if based on education. Education has multiple roles. Firstly, it needs to provide and endow with knowledge. Secondly, it needs to explore the mind of the student and identify his assets and work to better consolidate them. Thirdly, it needs to create a network between people and their minds. Fourthly, it needs to enhance people's ideas and thoughts and help them turn into reality. Quite a handful for education itself, but the handful can be achieved provided that the proper partnership between students and education is achieved. I would like to take this opportunity to extend an advice for the following days on debate. The topics of the conference focus on education and its resources. I would like to ask you to take a moment and ponder on a very valuable human resource, the educator itself. We often think of students, handbooks, teaching methods and evaluations, and we leave the educator behind. When in fact, the educator needs to receive as much attention as the others, and even more. Because what is a good teaching method in the absence of the good educator who knows how to implement it? Now that countries such as Great Britain have transformed the school into a computerized company, completely vanishing the professor from the educational activity, I urge you to think of enhancing the role of the educators. It is here that I would like to tell you a story, one of our renowned writers, Mikhail Sadovanu, wrote a story about his former teacher, Mr. Trandafir. In English, the name would be translated as Mr. Rose, which would add even more kindness and beauty to the character of the man in questions. But I'd rather to go with the Romanian version. Mr. Trandafir was a teacher of the three as reading, writing, and arithmetic in the Romanian countryside. These were done rather well, as Sadovanu points in the short story. But he adds that the most important teaching was another one, the one dedicated to one's soul. When he was teaching children heroic poetry, Mr. Trandafir would speak loud and clear and raise his eyes in pride. When he read them stories from national writers, he would keep the book close to his heart, look around to ensure their quietness, and then proceed with the story. He did all this, as Sadovanu would say, not because he was employed to do that, but because he was good and kind-hearted, just as an apostle. Mr. Trandafir was not a nationalist, nor romantic at heart. What Sadovanu points, in fact, is his dedication, passion for the mission he was entrusted with, and love for the students he worked with. To be clear, Mr. Trandafir was a 19th century teacher, somewhere rural and underdeveloped Romania, who had to work with limited results, but still educate. The difference stems from the dedication and commitment espoused by Mr. Trandafir, who knew how to approach his students and make sure that at the end of primary school, his student will have a basic knowledge, but most importantly, also a set of values that would guide them throughout their entire life. I strongly believe that we need to look for the Mr. Trandafir in the educator of the 21st century. This is why I urge you to think of this when approaching challenges of innovation in teaching. This cannot be possible without gifted individuals who would look at students as the human beings they are in charge of molding. And this is valid not just for primary students, but also high school and university students. It is high time we took a moment and focused also on educators, not just on students. We need to pay attention to who is becoming an educator and what reasons. We then need to invest in that person, make sure that he or she has access to the best resources in the field and is afterwards helped to further give this learning to his or her students. A good educator focuses on both knowledge and values, as knowledge is nothing without values. Kindness, fairness, solidarity, and friendship are some of the values that Mr. Trandafir would teach. Today's educators need to approach this at the same time as they speak about grammar, arithmetic, and spelling. During the pandemic, educators were left behind. And everyone focused on the lack of education on account of the restrictions. But just as students and parents, many educators face fears, frustrations, anxiety, and even the disease itself. Today, as it seems that we are entering a new phase of the pandemic with a new variant, I urge you to think of the future that lies ahead for the educators as well, and not just for the students. All of us today as a product of great educators, people who have taught us knowledge, as well as have shaped our characters and personalities. Let us not deprive our children and grandchildren of the same beneficial treatment. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Professor Constantinescu. Thank you very much for underlining that there is no education without teachers and without professors. It's true. In fact, the difficulty to build a good system of education is somehow also connected to the difficulty to keep the best and talented people in the education sector. Gary, you have the 8 minutes for the end of this inaugural session.
Thank you very much to all of our speakers for doing such a wonderful job of framing eloquently, with clarity, with emotion, the issues before us for this conference. I feel you have done it so comprehensively. In that sense, my job becomes very easy. What I'd like to do is very briefly put this context, this conference, if I can, in its widest possible perspective. Already most of that has been covered by our speakers very beautifully. In 2013, the World Academy of Art and Science was invited by the United Nations office in Geneva to collaborate on a conference on global challenges in the 21st century. And we had about 200 diplomats at that conference, and it brought to bear the burden with great power and clarity of what were the challenges facing humanity at that time. This was 5 years after the 2008 financial crisis. Economies were still recovering from massive unemployment and the collapse of financial markets. But fundamentally, when we look back on it, I would say it was a period of optimism. This was the period in which the 17 SDGs were in the process of formulation, achieving something unprecedented in the history of humanity. That was the thinking of the time. We were thinking confidently of a brighter future, but recognizing that the problems facing us were really tremendous. Now, when I look back, it's now 8 years later, the problems seem more formative even than they did then. Though we have made so much of progress in recognizing them and in taking unprecedented steps to address them. I think there's a reason for that. The conclusions that we drew in 2013 were that the problems we face today cannot be faced effectively by the existing system of governance at the national, multilateral, or institutional level. We need to go one step further to really work in global solidarity with a level of cooperation that is unprecedented, and which we see the first signs of that with the progress on the 17 SDGs, and more recently with the response to the COVID-19 pandemic. And more so, to the gradual awakening, too slow we will all feel, but significant progress in recognizing the need for global solidarity and action on climate change, which looms much more seriously in our minds today than it did just 8 years ago. So the challenges are unprecedented. It's also true that the opportunities, the potentials, and the capacities of the world are unprecedented. We have never had the magnitude of the resources, the magnitude of the technological capabilities, the communication, the networking, the technology, and so forth, that we have available today. But our conclusion was that's not enough. It's not enough we have these resources. We need fundamental changes in not only our public policies, not only in the institutions of governance at all levels, in business as well as in government and civil society. We also need fundamental changes in our educational system. And to go deeper than that, rather than thinking of education simply as an institutional activity, we need fundamental changes in the ideas on which our educational system is based. And many of the speakers today have already referenced to it, the compartmentalization of disciplines, the compartmentalization of cultural perspectives, and so forth. We need a new view of knowledge. We need to invent a new self-conception of our knowledge of humanity. And at even a deeper level than that, we need to change the way we think. This was the conclusions in 2013. I think that everything that's happened since has reaffirmed that need. I'd like to be very, I think with greatest gratitude, we can look back on the progress of education over the last 200 years and its contributions to humanity. We can say the same thing about many other sectors. But the question is, it's not enough. We need to do more. We have had the luxury of evolving very slowly, decade after decade after decade. And now, as several of the speakers have mentioned, the pace of development has accelerated so much. We don't have that luxury of a trial and error, hit and miss. We try this and then we change and go back to something else. We've got to convert this slow, somewhat faulty process of independent, isolated trial and error work into a conscious process of social transformation. At the global level, this is an unprecedented endeavor. So for me, essentially, this conference is not about education per se, though education is the heart of our discussion. It's about human equality and human rights. It's about human security. It's about the sustainability of life on this planet. And the reason we've put education at the center of it is because it is the area where, and leadership, of course, which many of you have mentioned, it's about the fact that without fundamental changes in this institution, we cannot achieve and rise to the challenges we face. Every institution in society has a role to play. Business, finance, government, civil society, no doubt about it. But I think none is more important than our educational institutions, or rather than education as an institution of society, rather than as a group of institutions working independently or in collaboration with each other, as a power for conscious social evolution. So I say this to indicate, make emphatic, that I realize we are doing what Federico Mayor started with. We're trying to reinvent a better future. And it doesn't come through the old methods. It doesn't come through the existing institutions. It doesn't come through the existing ways of thinking. With all appreciation for what has been achieved, we need an equally great sense of humility to recognize we need much more. We need much, much more than we have today. And no institution and no sector of society, if it really wants to sincerely address these issues, can be complacent with going ahead along existing lines. We're here today because education is such a valuable resource for us. We know we can do more with it. We know we can change much faster and more radically. And we've called together a wonderful group of speakers and a much larger audience who will be viewing and sharing and interacting with us in future to identify the levers, the catalysts for the global leadership we need in the 21st century. And I thank all of you who have got us off.